time, I didn't actually prepare a presentation with slides, organized with slides. It's much better, so I'm giving you a presentation built on work in progress. And you may come in, raise questions, make comments, criticism, it's much better. But unfortunately, I had a flashbang with me, and in that flashbang, just by chance, there are a few slides of, but really just by chance, because I used them for the course I gave with the US. And therefore, maybe one thing is I could go through the slides I had with me, not very many, and I could comment them and to take you into the topic. But before I do that, let me point out the fact that let's say the reason why I am interested in the city of we can't call them developing countries any longer. We can call them the cities of the South. Many people criticize this, the use of this term, but I haven't found any better term for the moment, so I will talk about the city of the South, the global South. The reason why I'm interested in that, the city of the South, the cities of the South, represent, as you may know, because I have no idea what your background is and whether you are familiar with the. I don't see the interpreter, so if I'm talking to. Yeah, I assume. If I'm talking too fast, just let me know somehow. Jump around to the box and tell me that. I don't know how familiar you are with the topic. The cities of the South are the cities which have made already, and are making even more in the coming years, but have made already the word in its, the population of the world, in its majority, as you may know, is by now mostly urban. For the first time in the history of the world, according to the United Nations, things which don't mean anything, but they mean something anyway. 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, depending on what you read, they have notified all of us that the world had become, for the first time, mostly urban. The majority of the population of the world, is by now, lives by now in urban areas, for the first time in the history of the world. This doesn't change much compared to what that was like 5 years ago, but tells us that there's this process of concentration of the population. And this process of concentration of the population, of urbanization, which has brought the world to become in its majority urban, is related, is due exclusively to the cities of the South, which have been growing for the past many decades, 5, 6 decades, 50, 60 years, they've been growing very fast, and they become central nodes of the special organization, of the world special organization. Okay? So, when I come from a university of architecture, planning in Italy, nobody cares about the city of the South in Italy. Nobody cares about the city in Italy. They think it's the center of the world. It's not. The center of the world is somewhere else. It's in the South, where cities are growing very, very rapidly. So I look at this phenomenon, and I try to get people in research, and I've been trying to understand. I'm not sure I have understood much, but I've been trying to understand for the past 4 years. How is it that cities which are growing so fast, so rapidly, are able, let's put it this way, are able to improve the living conditions of the population who's living there. So let's have a quick look at some slides which I just by chance, as I mentioned, have had in my flash. What has been for the past 50 years until the end of the last century? What has been the main feature of the city of the South? Well, its main feature has been what is referred to as dualism, a dual city, meaning by that the city of the South is made of two parts. And here we'll probably see only one part because I only have some slides. The two parts are, let's say, the modern city is usually referred to as the former city, the city which has been the part of the city which has been built using planning. Planning rules, planning indications, going to the municipality and trying to get the permission to build that kind of stuff. That's the former city. And then there is another part which is called the informal city, the legal city, the regular city, the informal city. Informal city is the most common way of referring to this part of the city. And the informal city is the city which has grown out of any planning norm, out of any building regulation. It's the city which has been built by, we use this term if I'm correct, but let's say by the inhabitants themselves. Okay? What you see in these slides is essentially the, as you can tell, the informal city. This is Dharawi, which is in Mumbai, India, considered to be one of the largest informal settlements in the world. Every country has its informal settlement, which is considered to be one of the largest informal settlements in the world. This is one of the largest informal settlements in the world. You can see the type of conditions, of living conditions, of housing, and in the background, you can see the former city. So there are these two parts, which are quite apart from one from the other, from the physical part. Okay. So this is the former city. Now, the point is that the former city, the cities of the South, make 30%, 40%, 60%. 80% of the total population of the city. Okay? So when we talk, from our point of view, researchers, people who try to understand how we can manage these type of urban conditions, what we look at, obviously, is the former part of the city. The former part can stand by itself, it solves its own problems by itself. This is the one which has most of the problems, of course, right? So this is Dharawi, Mumbai, 400,000, 500,000, nobody knows exactly how many people live here. And it's one of the many informal settlements in Mumbai. It's the largest one, but it's one. If we go through the slides quickly, this is also Dharawi. I mean, just comment on that, but it's obvious. What the issue is here is that the former city doesn't have any, well, have very precarious conditions, right? Let's put it like that. They don't have any sewage, they don't have any access to drinking water, they don't have, of course, any power supply, they don't have. If you go, but you know, it's not a problem. No sewage, no roads within the settlements itself. not roads in terms of, you know, four lanes roads, not even a path. Can you stay for a while? Not even, you know, a paved, a minimally paved road path where they can walk when it rains, or not walk on contaminated liquid, so to speak. They don't have anything of this kind. All right? You can go on. This is. I have only slides of these four assessments. There are thousands of assessments like this. This is in Salvador Bahia in Brazil, and it's called Nuevos Alagados. It's the new settlements of flooded people, if I'm going to say. Why? Because the water goes up from time to time when they get flooded. And the situation is very similar. The only thing is that there is some of the houses use bricks and not very precarious material. You can go on if you can. This is La Paz in Bolivia, the capital city of Bolivia. Here you don't even see, if I'm correct. You can see a part of the city, down the valley, in the middle of the valley, you can see somehow the former city. But the city is surrounded by informal settlements. Everywhere people have built their own housing, their own houses by themselves. Yes? This is very interesting in a way because it conveys, maybe in the best possible way, what the situation is in the cities of the south. It's somehow an extreme example. This is a city called Machot. Machot is the capital also of a country called Mauritania, which is in the central part of Africa, a city which should not exist, it doesn't have any reason to exist. But I don't want to go into it. And the people live like that, on the desert, on the sand, as you can imagine, also see, imagine as well, no water, no roads. No more school system, nothing. Okay. Let's go quickly through the other ones. All the same, the conditions may vary. This is Bogota. Bogota, like La Paz, is rather cold, so the people have to put up houses which have more solid material, but it's the same. It's the same, yes? And this is a fantastic view of Caracas, Venezuela. It's almost a painting, isn't it? I thought that we should give them some colors on there. And the issue, one of the issues that I'm doing, possibly the main issue, is what do we do? Maybe some of you are planners. Anarchists, I don't want to talk about. I don't want to hear any anarchist here. I am myself an anarchist. I don't want to hear any anarchist. I may accept some comments by planners, smart planners. What do we do here? Okay. And let's see what else we have. If we have anything else, do we have anything else? That's it. Yeah. Oh yeah. Let's talk to you again. Okay. This is the main feature of the city of the south. The dualism between the formal and the informal, and the fact that the informal city represents a large share, represents, accommodates, receives, has a large and often the largest share of the urban population. Okay. Can you go back to Caracas? This way. Okay. What should I tell you? Let me mention the fact, first of all, that cities, the municipal administration, the city administration of this part of the world, have a very, the resources available to the local government are very, very limited. As you may know, I attended the Moscow Urban Forum. Some figures have been passed around for serving Moscow. I don't have them with me. I was very surprised to see that Moscow has a budget which is lower than that of New York and Singapore, I think, where the two examples given, but not that lower than these two cities. I don't make up the calculations, but it seems to me that, that we are speaking of something like $5,000 or euros, per person, but I'm not quite sure. $5,000 or whatever per person, which can be used by the government to make the city work and to invest, to make new investments. Okay? Right. These cities have 5 euros per person when they are lucky. Mexico City has 350. But other cities, like Phnom Penh, for instance, in Cambodia, when I worked there, the budget for the government was zero. So again, if there is any planner among you, the question is, what can we do? Not only in terms of it's difficult, materially, physically, but it's also difficult in terms of, or almost impossible, in terms of the resources available. I always tell my students, you know, one day you will be hired by the mayor of Caracas, who will ask you, how can we bring water to this country? And you will come up saying, oh, dear mayor, it's obvious. We'll build an aquifer, a water supply system. Forget it, there's no money. There's no money for that. So that's not the solution. So the issue here is that in the cities of the south, the city of the south, the city of the capital city, there's a total mismatch between the conditions, the conditions of a large part of the population and the resources available to the government what would be, or what we think would be needed to do. So please keep this in mind. And this is important. I mean, we have to take a totally different view from what we think in Europe. I don't know anything about Moscow, but I believe from the type of perspective or approach or whatever you may have in Moscow, right? I don't know anything, but I'm not sure that. Let's do this. No, you have no money. Let's get it. Whatever. Switch system. Solid waste. What do you do? We'll send a truck to collect the solid waste, right? There's no road. There's no road. So forget it. And you don't have a truck. And if you have a truck, it will break down very soon, and that's it. So forget going around with the type of approach. Planning approach, management approach, technology, we're used to. No, doesn't exist. So let's keep that in mind. The other point at the same time, on the other hand, which I want to make, is that somebody said a few quite a number of years ago. Somebody was working on these issues, was looking at them, was also working on the field. So somebody came up with this strange idea and said, you see, look at that. Well, this is not the problem. This is the solution. I'm talking about. This is the solution. It seems to be a problem to me. Well, it's not a problem. It's the solution. He was totally right. Why is it that these informal assessments, you can go back to Manchot, if you want, all the things we have seen, why is it that these are the solution? Not the best solution of all, but they are the solution. See, if you follow me, if you don't follow me, just say, I don't understand. Why is it that it is the solution? Let's take the viewpoint, the starting point, sort of planner's point of view. The planners, I am an architect by training, a planner by I don't know what, and I don't know anything now, so that's mine. The planner's point of view would be, no, you can't have a city like that. A city can only grow, can only expand on the basis of well-established, defined rules. The plan, right? If you want to expand the city, you have to follow the rules and the indications of the master plan. Right. Because planners know how a city should be in the future. They are convinced that they know. So they draw plans for these cities. Now the problem is that these cities, particularly in the past decades, even today in some areas, have grown very, very fast. Grown very, very fast. People have moved to. It's more complicated than that. But let me put it this way. People have moved quickly from the rural areas to the city. And they come into the city. I woke up one morning and I decided that I had enough to live or to survive, or not to survive, in my village. So I decided that I better move into the city. And me first, and as soon as possible, my family. And me first. So I went to the city, got into the city, and the first need I have is to have a house, a shelter, we use the word shelter, right? Where to stay for night, huh? Where to sleep. So I make it very, very rough and very brief. So I don't even know what a plan is, right? I come from the village. I don't even know what a master plan is. But somebody around tell me, no, look, you cannot go there because there is a plan there. And if you want to build a house there, you have to get a permit. The house has to be such and such. It has to have two bathrooms, three parking places, I don't know. Better if you stay outside the area plan by plan. Because there you may build by yourself and what you are able, financial terms, to build. So the guy sets up a shelter, like the one we saw in Chomp particularly. You can put it up overnight and stay there. Of course, I'm not talking about one person. I'm talking about the case of Dhaka in Bangladesh, where for the past 15-20 years, and for the next 15-20 years, 500,000 people will move into the city per year. 500,000 people, okay? Which by Moscow terms is not a very high number of persons, but by Italian standards, I can tell you. There are only three cities which are larger than 500,000 people. So if you think of, yeah. And all of these people, most of these people moving in every year are very poor. So they settle where they can. And the product is this one. But why isn't it a problem but a solution? Well, it's very simple. It's very simple, but we never think. We're not sufficiently aware of this. It's very simple. And it is the fact that people move from the countryside, from the rural areas, and move from the rural areas to the city because they could not survive in rural areas. So, you cannot tell them why do you come to the city under these conditions? Because the conditions in the rural area are much worse. Much worse. So people move, and they're right. Because they move to the city, and in the city they find, even though it may seem unlikely, but I can tell you, they find better conditions, better opportunities to have an income, to find a work, to find a job, maybe in the informal sector. In the informal sector. But they do find a job, they do get an income, they are able to send money back to their family, and they are able to make their families come over to the city. So they are right to move into the city, because their conditions, the living conditions in the city, though it may seem strange, are better than those they left behind in the rural areas. But not only that. If I follow the line of the guy, John Turner, who said, this is not problem is the solution. I will tell you that people not only are right in moving from the countryside to the city. I will go further and I will tell you that we, the government, should push them to come to the city. Why? Well, because cities over the years, and by now, since say the 80s, since 30 years ago, 40 years ago, 30 years ago, but even before, the cities are the place where the wealth of a country, the larger share of the wealth of a country, gross national product, is produced. Okay? All countries of the South, by now, in all countries of the South, by now, the wealth of the country, the economic growth of the country, takes place in urban areas. Okay? So people, and why is that? It's because people have moved to the urban areas. So they help the country grow economically. So by moving to the city or by leaving the cities, they improve their living conditions and they increase the national product of the country. So should any one of you think that they should go back and please be aware of the fact that you are wrong. They have to be in the city, they have to come to the city. Thanks God they come to the city. That's why it's not a problem, it's the solution. On the other hand, what planners may tried to sell you, or to sell me, is, okay, let's consider that it's good that they climb to the city, that they move to the city. But they shouldn't settle like that. They should follow the indications of the plan, of the master plan. I believe a similar process took place in Moscow a few days ago, but I don't know. And so they shouldn't be allowed, they shouldn't be allowed to settle like that. Because of course this creates, we say challenges, not to use the word problems, they say challenges, okay? Of course, to improve the living conditions of an area like that is quite demanding. It's not simple. So they shouldn't be allowed to settle like that. Right. Plan. Somebody arrives. He settles out of your fantastic master plan. You say, no, you can't do that. No. You can't settle that. Because there's a plan. And so the guy says, yeah, okay, right, you're right, there's a plan, I will stick to the plan. Problem is that I don't have any money to build in the area designated by the plan as residential areas with the rules which are defined by the plans for building a house, two bathrooms, one kitchen of 14 square meters, two parking, you don't have the money. That's unfortunate. Well, maybe, says the guy, maybe the government could help me building a house according to what the plan says. The government has no money. So here we have people coming from the rural areas to escape from the terrible conditions they have in the rural areas. They move to the city, helping the city and the country to grow economically and socially, etc. and so on. And here we have somebody telling them, no, I don't like this. I don't like this. You can't do that. What should I do? Well, I know. I'm not able to provide you what we call in Europe social housing, right? I can provide social housing, they did it at the beginning. These countries, these cities did it. Because they did it. They built a certain number of public housing. But the number of public housing which was built was totally insufficient compared to the demand. 500,000 people, 500,000 people arrive every year in Dhaka. They are able to build, let's say even housing for 100,000 people, which is not the case, and the remaining 400,000 people will be there. You stop them at the border. You tell them not to build. That's why it's not the problem; it's the solution. And the planners and be afraid of what artists say, that's by definition. Be afraid of what planners may say, that unless planners are very sufficiently cautious and smart, etc. And the point is that one has to look at these things with a very different perspective. I could talk to you about, I've taken housing because it's the most evident feature of the complexity of the city of the south. We could take anything else. We could take water. Usually we talk about water and sanitation because they go together. I could talk to you about, as I mentioned, solid waste, collection of solid waste. I talk to you about transportation, public transportation. All these things that the government cannot provide. The large majority of the population with these type of services, because they don't have enough money. And therefore, the city of developing countries has grown, let's say, I need a whole portion, let's say it has grown by itself, okay? By itself, both in terms of housing and in terms of service provision. People organize themselves in order to find ways of responding to their needs. Okay. Many, as you can imagine, there are many issues related to these type of things. I'll make one other point, because I wonder whether it may be helpful to listen to this type of statement by me, if you have never bumped into this type of things, thinking. For many years, and even today, there have been people around, very smart people, who have told us that cities in developing countries, let me just show you a few figures. Can you please go to the tables? For many years there have been people around who were telling us the city in developing countries, the cities in developing countries. Can you go to the third one? This one. That's perfect. Okay, very good. This one shows you the size of the first largest cities in developing countries in the world in 1950, the year 2000, and the year 2025, the latest projection we have. You see the cities of the so-called developed world, and in light you see the cities of the so-called developed countries. And you can see very rapidly that from 1950 to the year 2000 already, and even more if you look at the year 2005, the largest cities are going to be, most of the largest cities, most of the 30 largest cities in the world, sources United Nations, are going to be in the so-called South, okay? So many people have been around many years still today, say they are too large. These cities are too large. Mexico City is 18 million in the year 2000. I can see exactly. Dhaka is 32 million in the year 2025. I mean, these are too large. Too large. If the city is too large, it means that there is a optimum city size. If you say a city is too large, certainly you know what is the good large. I know how to put it. You know, what is the good large for a city? What is it? 5 million? In Italy, forget it's 5 million. It's too large. 1 million? I don't know. 15 million, who knows? So, this I always want to convey this. There's no such thing as too large. No such thing as too large. A city may become too large when people start moving out, when what we refer to as negative externalities become more important than positive externalities. I move to a city, I benefit from it. I move to the city, or I stay in the city, I only receive disadvantages, so I move out. But until people move in, it means that the city can receive this person. So the idea of too large is absolutely mistaken. Absolutely mistaken. Now, the title of my lecture, and I will only briefly talk about this, the title of my lecture is from the city of developing countries to the emerging city area. Why is it? And I've also provided the organizer with a short paper I've recently written to make some publicity myself. Okay? So I think you can get it from somewhere. Because things have changed. Have changed a lot in the last 10 years and are still changing. For those of you who may be familiar with these types of cities, I'm sure you would agree with what has happened in the last 15 years. This dualism between the poor city and the wealthy city, which I referred to at the beginning, it's still there, of course, the divide. Deep that it will take years before it wanes out, if it ever wanes out. But what is happening is that we can definitely see, now let me make it even more clear, the physical appearance of the dual city, the formal city and the informal city. What is it? This is simply the result, or it's a result, it's a consequence of the existence of a dual society where you had a small number of people well off and a large number of people poor. And it's still there. But this was a dual city, is a consequence. Of the dualism, which is one of the typical features of the societies, was one of the typical features, one of the major features of the society in the developing countries. That's all right, many consequences, I don't have the time to go into it. What has happened in the last? Well, let me start from the end. What has happened and what is happening is that we see the emergence, the appearance, the rising of. Let me use this words, but they're not correct in scientific terms, the rise of the middle class. So this dualism which existed at the beginning between the poor and the minority of wealth is being modified by the fact that a growing number of people are coming out of poverty. So middle class doesn't work because middle class, to us at least in Europe, means it's a sociological notion which has a number of consequences. So, in my paper, I use the word a consuming middle class. People who have come out of poverty, who for the first time are able to save some money, not use it for daily survival, and therefore they are able to buy. Just to give you a very quick and I hope very very meaningful sign of this is, I think you're familiar with that. Have you ever heard of the nano car produced by Tata? Tata started to produce 4 or 5 years ago the nano, right? Very small car. We had a similar thing in Italy with the 600-500 anni benissimo. So Tata started to produce the dam. Why did they start to produce the dam? Because there was a market. And the market was this part of the population who had come out of poverty and who obviously was his priority. Priority number one was, I don't know whether it was one, number two, was to have a car. So they immediately started to produce a nano car. Didn't work. Why? Well, I'm not an expert on it, but it's easy to understand. If I come out of the of my status as poor, I don't want to be identified as somebody who has come out of the status of poor. You can only access the nano car. I want to access a higher level car because it didn't work. But that's another story. What we are seeing now is that is the emergence in every country, even in African countries, sub-Saharan African countries, when I say African, I mean sub-Saharan, of this population who's able to access goods produced by the market, okay? And in particular, what we are seeing is that the construction sector in these countries, the private sector, has started to build and to offer on the market, of the private market, housing units, houses. Okay? This did not exist until a few years ago because nobody was able to access these houses. Nobody had the money to access. You go to South Africa, you go to Chile, you go to Mexico, you go to India, you go to Kenya, anywhere. What you see? You see huge housing developments. You see huge housing developments which are built by the private sector, and obviously they are built by the private sector because there is demand. So what's happening is that instead of having a dual city, due to the fact that there was a dual society, now you are seeing the appearance of a more differentiated type of city, okay? Because there is a more differentiated type of society. Now, I will stop here because it's a complicated issue. But this has enormous consequences on the policies which have been implemented, carried out in the past 40 years in these cities in order to cope with the problem, which was not a problem but a solution, starting from the idea that it was a solution, but there were policies to cope with that living conditions. Now this is going to have a tremendous consequence, and these policies have to change radically. So what we are seeing in a way is the move from a situation where you had a developing world versus a so-called economically advanced world. Now things have changed. Most of the countries of the so-called developing world, as you might know, have a rate of growth, economic growth, of between 7, 10, even 12%. So very, my country, for the last 5 years, due to the economic crisis, has had a negative rate of growth. And if we are able to achieve a 1% economic growth in the coming years, we will be very happy. These countries, the other countries, the developing world, not just people, China, of course, but even countries like Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, 7%, 8%. And this means that large, a considerable part of the population is coming out of poverty. So everything is changing. I wasn't able to understand very well how it worked the city before. I will be even less able to understand how the city will work in the coming months. Thank you very much.
Functions and space, okay? So it's an interesting because
going through something which is being denied in a way or opposed now in cities, the cities of Europe. Or so, from the point of view of the cities of developing countries, I think they still have to go through a certain process before they get to be able to see that this functionalism of a different doesn't work. Because they've been into it as being poor for many years. In terms of other cities, I'm not really an expert on that, we see it more and more, this idea of refusing the suggestions which became rule of the Athens Charter, in fact, right? Of the rationalistic planning, okay, with zoning. More and more, I would say, certainly in Italy, you no longer work on this basis of you know, zoning has been denied totally. I have to add, I have to add the fact that in most European countries, as you probably know, cities don't grow any longer. The population of cities doesn't grow, and therefore there's no planning for expansion. There's only planning for reorganizing one site, some urban space which already exists. So the situation is a bit different from what I believe is going to be for the next couple of decades, at least in Moscow. So in European cities, planners are working on this idea of reinforcing the mix of uses in the city. Less so, I would say, about, since I gave a talk on this topic at the urban forum, less so in terms of mix of population. I'm thinking of the migrant population who has moved into most European cities, the part of Europe I come from. Planning is not able yet to deal with the presence of diversity. And this is another extremely interesting on one side and challenging topic. I could give you an example, I don't have anything to show, but I'm trying to make myself understood as much as possible. In Italy, there are many projects, I would say, let's say projects, but to reorganize more than rehabilitate, let's say reorganize the areas around the railway stations, okay? Very deteriorated, often by so-called marginal population, of course, nodes of flows of people, because people arrive and move and go. So there are many projects, many railway stations in Italy which are interested by such projects. Now, what it turns out, I've studied in a way the case of Naples, it turns out that the area in front of the railway station of Naples, which is the third city by size in Italy, it turns out that this area is very lively, very dynamic, very economically active, due to the fact that there are different types of populations using it during different hours of the day. There are the informal, the street vendors, let's say, there are obviously the shops around there. There are the people come in, the commuters. So this is a space which has different features, social and economic features during the day. Now there is a project by a very well-known French architect, by the way, and the project is not bad, but the project by definition is there is going to be that, and there is going to be that, and there is going to be that. You can't say from 6 o'clock in the morning up to 10 o'clock there will be the commuters coming in, and therefore we need to have this type of space organized in such a way, and then somebody else moves in. So what seems to me is that the city, the contemporary city, has become so much more complex in functions and even in time, over time, that planning is lagging behind. It doesn't really know how to deal with these things. Planning is almost by definition static, and this is a challenge. This is very interesting. What do we do with a city which is so, somebody would use the word fluid, no? And as a planner, I wouldn't be able to tell you what we can do. I think we have to reconsider deeply our, I don't know whether you are a planner. You look like a planner, of course. We have to reconsider deeply our discipline and our professional tools, because the city has changed totally. The city with the capital C, I mean, now every city has its peculiarities. I don't think I answered to you, but that was not a bad answer, right? Thank you.